Good morning, Dimples.
Good morning. How are you? Are you back in Delhi?
Yes, I'm back in Delhi.
Okay. So what, it was a business trip, is it?
No, so my daughter chose India for her college and she's chosen Bangalore Shishti. So I'd want to settle her in college.
Okay. What is she doing?
She's doing industrial design.
Oh, nice. Okay.
So she's clear about a roadmap, 4 years in Shishti, 2 years in RISD, America. She's very clear. So I said, okay, with her in the journey.
You know, it's nice, youngsters. I think they're a lot more focused.
Yeah.
Right. In this, a lot of them, at least. I was shocked. I remember when I went to the US about 3-4 years ago on one of my trips when I was told that my grandson, my daughter has just the one son, he wanted to do filmmaking. So he's doing a bachelor's in film production at a particular college, it's in Virginia, Lynchburg. It has a very strong media department. So I was a bit concerned, but apparently this is all the different technical aspects of filmmaking, you know?
Right.
So I guess there's all kinds of fields open to kids nowadays. We look at a lot of very conventional streams.
They are kind of, they're there, but the newer ones have taken up the center stage.
And now when the pandemic hit, it struck me, I said, gosh, you know, there's so much more time people will spend on digital platforms.
Yes.
Maybe it is a good line that he's got into, because I can see all of us going into more of a virtual world going forward.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Wonderful. I'm very interested in today's chapter. I think Panchakosha, it's going to be nice to learn something new. So
this is again, as I said, a prakriya, no? A teaching model. So Panchakoshas is, when they try and explain to you, they say how the Anamaya Kosha is in the physical body, the stool shariram, you know. The pranamaya, the manomaya, and the vijnanamaya are in the sukshma shariram. Why is that? Do you know why that is?
The Pranamaya, the Manamaya, and Sukshma Sharir.
And Vijnanamaya Kosha are all in your subtle body. They're not in your physical body. Why is that?
Because they're always there, a part of your subconscious mind, whatever you're learning.
Because your mind, that is it. Your mind is in your... So when we did the subtle body, if you remember, we talked about the 19 or the 17 components, whichever way you look at it. So the five pranas were there, the sense organs of perception, organs of action, and the mind and the intellect, that made it 17. If you added chitta and what was the other one? The mind, okay. We have mana and we have buddhi and we have chitta and we have ahankara, you know. So you either take it as four or they take it just as the mind and the ahankara is two. So it's 17 components or 19, depending on which way you look at it.
Absolutely.
So your pranamaya kosha is where the physiological functions work, right? So that has to be in the subtle body because the five pranas are there. The pranas are what leave with the subtle body when you stop breathing and you die, right?
Right.
So pranamaya kosha is in the subtle body. The manomaya, which is your emotional mind, is also there. And so is the vijnanamaya, which is your intellect.
Hmm.
So those three. So anamaya is made out of food. So obviously it is a physical body that you can see. And the fifth one, of course, is the anandamaya, which is in your karna shariram, which is that state of avidya. You know, deep sleep state when you're totally unaware of anything and you're total bliss because you don't even know what, you know, you're in such deep sleep. So that's the way it is.
Wonderful. So looking forward to reading about this.
Yeah.
Today is chapter 10, Panchakoshas. Next, we shall see the Panchakoshas or the Kosha Panchakam. Kosha is another technical name used for the bodies themselves. The Shariram itself is called Kosha from another angle. Literally, the word kosha means a cover. The sheath or encasement in which a knife is kept is called a kosha. Ananmaya kosha, the three bodies themselves are divided into the five koshas from the standpoint of their function. This division is a functional division of three bodies. The sthula shariram is a gross body, is also known as ananmaya kosha. Its function is receiving anam, which is food, and growing with the help of anam. After its death, it becomes food for the next generation. Pranamaya kosha, the sukshma shariram, consists of 17 or 19 organs, is subdivided into three koshas based on three functions or three faculties. Each kosha represents one power or faculty. The three faculties are kriya shakti, the power of action or activity. The Ichha Shakti, the power of desire, and Jnana Shakti, the power of knowledge. In fact, our entire life is an expression of this threefold faculty only. When we read the newspaper to gain knowledge of various things like the Jnana Shakti is functioning. When we become interested in particular program or discourse, it's Ichha Shakti, the faculty of desire starts functioning. When we go to attend this discourse, Kriya Shakti starts functioning. When we attend the discourse and listen to the speech again, Jnana Shakti functions. Desire is preceded by knowledge because I cannot desire for something I do not know. Hence, desire is produced because of knowledge. However, every knowledge need not be followed by desire, whereas every desire is preceded by knowledge. Thus, the whole life is the three faculties functioning together. A human being remains unique because of these three faculties only. If animals are inferior, it is only because these three faculties are inferior in them. A cow or a dog does not wish to attend discourses, nor does it think of planning for the future. Whereas a human being can do these. Man has landed on the moon because of the extraordinary power of these shaktis. The five-fold prana, along with five karmendriyas, sense organs of action, form the pranamaya kosha. The five-fold prana serves as the energy tank or the fuel tank, which consumes food, processes it, converts it into energy. Fueled by this energy, the Karmendriyas express the Kriya Shakti. Do you want to elaborate this a bit for all of us, Dimples?
Yeah, so as I was telling you, these three koshas are in the subtle body. So the Pranamaya kosha is divided, to get back to the subtle body, we've talked about the 17 or the 19 components of the subtle body. 17 is if you take the mind only as the mind and the intellect. And 19 is if you add to the mind, the intellect, you take the intellect and the ego, the ahankara, the I sense. Then it becomes 17. But when you add the emotional mind and the memory bank, it becomes 19. So it's just a semantic difference. There's no great difference there. So they say that we have three shaktis in us, you know, the power of action, the power of desire, and the power of knowledge. As Swamiji has explained here, desire can only come when there is knowledge of something. You cannot desire a bag or something if you don't even know that particular brand, for example. And the power of activity. In our entire life, as he says, we are only expressing these threefold faculties. And they talk about the difference between humans and animals is because we have these faculties well developed. But other than that, there's not much to say. The fivefold prana with the five karmendriyas, which are the organs of action, form the pranamaya kosha. The fivefold pranas are in charge of the fivefold physiological functions of the body. You know, your udana, your samana. We did that, I think, in an earlier.
Yes, we did.
So that is what keeps the body functioning, the circulatory system, the respiratory system, the digestive system, what have you. And the organs of action, what we discussed were, they're again based on, when we did the Sukshma Shariram in an earlier chapter, it describes the different organs of function, which is what make you act, your grasping, your touch, your locomotion, all that. Those are called the sense organs of action. The Manomaya Kosha is where the sense organs of perception are. These are organs of action. Those are organs of perception. So that
means we'll read about them now. Yeah.
Nothing much. It's quite self-explanatory. Yeah.
Perfect. So Manomaya Kosha, its next faculty is Ichha Shakti, or the faculty of desire. This is represented by six organs, the first five sense organs of knowledge and mind. Desire can arise only if we gather information through the sense organs. Desire is needed again for experiencing the external world through the sense organs. At both stages, sense organs are involved. Therefore, Ichha Shakti requires sense organs. This group, consisting of the five sense organs and the mind, is called Manomaya Kosha, which represents Ichha Shakti. So basically, all the five sense organs, along with the mind, is called Manomaya.
Because, if the mind is not there, the sense organs can't function.
Right.
And the six sense organs are the ones that are the input data.
Right.
They go out, they see the world, they see this, that, and the other. Oh, I need to go to Switzerland. I'd love to do this. I'd love to do that. That's because the sense organs are interacting with the world. So between the sense organs and the mind, they are the ones that are responsible for our Ichha Shakti, or the faculty of desiring things. Okay. And that is all in the Manomaya Kosha.
Very nice. Right. Then the next one is Vijnanamaya Kosha. The next faculty is Jnana Shakti, which is also represented by six organs, the five sense organs of knowledge called the Jnanendriyas and Buddhi. It is to be remembered that for gaining any knowledge, we require intellect, but intellect cannot gain any knowledge unless there are sense organs to report from the external world. Thus, Jnanendriyas together with Buddhi represent Jnana Shakti, which is also called Vijnanamaya Kosha, the rational or intellectual faculty.
Please note, Shastra is always doing, when they talk of the mind and they talk of the intellect, okay, we understand there are two ways of looking at the mind. You can look at the mind with its four divisional functional divisions, right? But when they talk of the Manomaya Kosha here, they're talking about that emotional mind, the mind that is unsure, Sankalp Vikalp, they call it, you know, did I, should I, should I not, and all. Whereas when they talk of the Vijnanamaya, they're talking about the Buddhi, they mean that very decisive, discriminating intellect. So they, you know, like you can be very emotional at times, and when you're emotional, you're actually, your intellect doesn't work, it gets clouded. It's only when you're calm and peaceful that your intellect can see very objectively and clearly. So whenever they refer to Buddhi, they're referring to that aspect of the mind. And when they refer to the mana or the mind, they're referring to the emotional aspect. So Vijnanamaya is the discriminating, decisive, clear intellect, Buddhi. That's what they mean when they say Buddhi.
Right. Yeah, rational, intellectual, both faculties are involved. Yeah.
So that's why Manomaya is where the emotions are more, you know, desire, this, that, and the other. The Vijnanamaya is where the intellect works. Yeah, it's nice, but do I really need it? But why is this situation happening? How do I deal with it? Not saying, oh, what's happening? What should I do? This person's hurting me and all. No, all that is your reactive nature, which comes in the Manomaya. But it's a Vijnanamaya that steps back, gets objective.
Right.
You know, that creating space. Yeah.
Very nice. Now comes the Anandamaya Kosha. The current Shariram is the only one left out. This is called Anandamaya Kosha. Current Shariram plays a prominent role in deep sleep state because everything is resolved in deep sleep state. Then we are total relaxation. We don't experience any division or limitation. So everyone is happy in deep sleep state. That is in current Shariram. When I am awake, I cannot say I am always happy. In the dream state also, I am often disturbed by nightmares. Therefore, both the waking state as well as the dream state do not guarantee happiness. The deep sleep state alone gives me happiness in a uniform manner. There is no one who does not love sleep. Sleep is a universally called phenomenon, loved phenomenon. It is Ananda. Therefore, Karana Shariram is called Anandamaya Kosha. How wonderful.
But the whole purpose of all this, talking about the three states, the three bodies and the five koshas, is what? That they are all anatma. That is your next paragraph.
Yeah. All right. So anatma, all these put together, Shaira Trayam, Avastha Trayam, Kosha Panchakam, is called Anatma, which can be roughly translated as matter. This is because Thula Shariram is gross matter, Sukshma Shariram is subtle matter, and Karan Shariram is the subtlest form of matter. All of these are nothing but matter at different levels. Science considers energy also as another form of matter. While science talks about two different levels of matter, gross and subtle, Vedanta speaks of causal matter also. This causal matter is avidya. Other than this anatma, the scriptures point out that there is another entity called atma, which is the self or spirit.
So the reason, I don't know, science is coming to it, they're calling it, as I said, singularity, is because they talk of gross matter and subtle matter. But Vedanta, as he says, talks of causal matter, where the matter is in total unmanifest form. You can say this is gross, this is subtle, but that unmanifest form is what is called avidya and causal. So science has not got a full explanation for that yet. They're still working on it. But that the Shastra has talked about.
But everything is unmanifested. If you look around, the causal matter is so high, which is not yet tapped by science as such.
Yes.
Yeah.
They will go up to water can be boiled and become steam and become vapor and things like that and come again. But there is something beyond that, that potential.
Yeah.
That I think science is still, quantum physics is working on it. So they are getting. Now we are getting to the most important part of this entire study that we are doing.
Yes.
Which is the Atma.
And I'm so amazed because today morning, just at 7 o'clock, we finished our studies of unifying with our own Atma. Just finished a 6-month course on, you know, meeting our own Atma. It was so beautiful. And here we are again starting the journey.
No, so what I have to explain something to you is that the thing is, when they talk about creation and they talk, I think I mentioned once, no, Sat and Mithya, Satyam and Mithya. So they say the only one object, if you want to call it that, or one category or whatever it is, the only thing that is Satyam. Satyam, according to Shastra, is that which independently can exist. And that is consciousness, which is existence consciousness, or chit, okay? Everything else is dependent on it. None of us can exist if we didn't have that consciousness. If we didn't have existence, what would we be? They're just elements all around. It's all matter. So the problem with us is that there is a receptacle, let us say, and it has a finer inner essence. We take ourselves to be the receptacle. Whereas the receptacle, which is this body, is there for a length of time, could be 70, 60, 80 years, we don't know. That essence is what our true nature is. And that essence is that all-pervading consciousness. We call it Paramatma, we call it God, whatever it is. But that same essence or that same consciousness is what is giving us sentiency. And that is what our true nature is. And that is where we have to get to. Now, the nature of Atma, I think, will be explained here.
Yeah, very nice. So, this nature of Atma, shall we start next time or shall we?
Yes, we can start it next time. It would be a good idea if people read it a wee bit. If you read it, yeah. If there's any questions, I'll also read it again because I need to do a revision. And yes. We can.
And to everyone who's hearing us virtually or here online, we've done 10 chapters. It's not a bad idea to actually summarize the 10 chapters in your own words and probably come up with questionnaire next time if you're not ready to start with Atma, because Atma is the final, in a way, the final realization as the consciousness. So if you have any questions before we reach Atma or Srishti, then it'll be nice to have some question answers. But if you're ready for the journey, we'll start. Because there's so much that we've done about Avidya, about Sthula Sharira, Karan Sharira. We've done about so many avasthas, how the body is into this. So if you have any questions or new terminologies there for you, please go through it and then come back to us. Otherwise, we start Atma next Thursday.
And what is very useful to always remember is the components of the three bodies, which we've done in the Sharira Trayam.
Yeah.
As long as you remember that, you know, your sense organs are there, your organs of action, the power of the organs of action. Okay, you can say the organ of action is a hand. It's actually an instrument. But the actual power of the hands to operate is in the subtle body. That understanding of that concept, if it is there, everything becomes a lot clearer.
Hmm. Plus, I also feel for everyone, there's no harm in rereading the, rehearing the chapters. You already have a YouTube link. Just go through them again on your, whatever you're doing. You don't have to have a book in front of you. It's very slowly read and explained by Dimples. So if you have any questions, it's going to be nice to hear back also. And maybe make your own reflective notes also. So that'll, anything put in paper, you kind of, it's imprinted in your mind. So maybe we should get into that as well. Just a reflection from my side. But of course, each to their own. So next week, Yeah.
The other thing I wanted to tell you was, I think I mentioned to you about Shastra Prakashika. I mean, I know they're longish talks because each class of Swami Paramahansananda is about an hour. But whenever you're traveling or whatever, if you've downloaded the app and you download some of the contents there, which could be like introduction to Vedanta, it could be even general talks, it could be Tattva Bodha, which is what we are doing. He explains that, see, those are 14, 15 classes of 1 hour each. So they in-depth understanding of what he's saying.
What is the app's name? Sorry, I didn't get you.
Shastra Prakashika.
I don't know why I missed it. Shastra Prakashika. Okay, I'm going to try.
At iTunes, you can, S-A-S-T-R-A. It's not S-H.
No? Okay.
So S-A-S-T-R-A. There's 40 years of teaching there.
Wow.
There's 13 volumes, general talks. There are, I don't know, or 13 of them. Then there are, I was just looking, there are Vedanta classes and there Brahma Sutras, anyway, other texts. If we go to other texts in Vedanta classes, oh no, they're quite tough, some of them. Guided meditations are there. I'm sure in that other text, question and answers is very interesting. Sadhana Panchakam is there. There is Tattva Bodha is in two volumes.
So there are two of them. One is Shastra Prakashika, one word, and the other is Shastra and Prakashika, separate words.
This has got a kind of a the icon.
Lotus kinds?
Lotus, a kind of a mustardy with a white lotus.
I got it.
Don't complicated text initially. Go with the general stuff.
Yeah.
Get a sense of what. It's very good when you're traveling. Just put on your iPod and listen to it.
Perfect.
Okay.
So thank you for this valuation on this beautiful Guruvar. The highest in me bows to the highest in you. May this be a wonderful day of love, light, and blessings.
For you too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. Bye-bye.